So my job today actually is to help you a little bit to try to understand why some of the patients with Chiari are going through such a difficult time with pain management. Sometimes it's just difficult to accept, right? You have a surgery, things are getting better, they did what they were supposed to do, and you still have pain. Why is that an aspirin? Why is that ibuprofen doesn't help? What's going on there? So this is what we are trying to explore today. And the answer to that, in short, is that it's just very difficult. Pain is a very complex phenomenon. We say pain, but when we say pain, it's just a very large umbrella, and under that we have many, many different, many syndromes and many, many presentations. The one that we are more familiar with is the nociceptive pain. This is a normal response. This is what we want. It helps us. If we are going to grab something that is really hot and we retrieve the hand because we feel hot, we feel the pain, that's a good thing. We want that. It's protecting us. And this is engraved in the very, very primitive type of mechanisms that we have in the brain. And typically we see it when we have direct tissue invasion. For example, if you have cancer, what it's doing is pressing on other structures. What you are doing is exciting. You are stimulating normal responses. And you see it in many, many different type of conditions. And you see it in post-op pain. For example, if you are having surgery, the skin is being cut, muscles are being spread, things are being moved around. So you are stimulating these fibers. And this is normal, this is okay. And eventually this resolves. And the way that we treat it is if you are having a surgery, most likely you are going to have during the surgery, right after the surgery, some opiates. You are going to get some non-steroidals, anti-inflammatory agents, maybe IV like Tylenol now that is available. To decrease the use of opioids, but then eventually you are going to use a little bit of opioids for a few days until you recover from that. And this is the typical type of pain that we talk about. But there is another type of pain, which is neuropathic pain, and this is when the problem really starts. Neuropathic pain is not a normal response, it's an abnormal response from the body. It's something that we really don't want because it doesn't help us. It's a pain that stays there even if the stimuli has been removed. So you touch something that is hot, you move your hand away, but the pain is still there. Why does it help you? Why do you want this type of pain? And the problem is that it's very challenging to treat. And also is present in many, many common conditions. Like for example, if you look worldwide, the most common cause for neuropathic pain would be leprosy, for example. But in the industrialized countries like this, then diabetes would be on top of the list. But then you have a bunch of many other conditions that may cause it. Cancer, for example, will be close to the top of the list, and the reason is because you may have neuropathic pain that is caused by the cancer itself, but also induced by the medications that you are taking. Very difficult to treat because you have to make then a decision. What do? You treat the cancer or you stop the medications? How do you deal with that? And then the other issues that we find is post-op pain that may really, as Dr. Vesk was saying before, is like a failed surgery. What happened with this pain? Why is this pain doesn't get better? Well, sometimes because it has a neuropathic component to it. And the way that we treat it, as you can see there, is different, the way that we treat it. Okay, this is working great. So typically we said in the nociceptive pain, which is the normal pain, which is a normal mechanism that we want, what we do is we can use non-steroidals like ibuprofen we said before, then we move to other type of strategies, right, if this doesn't work. Now, if you have neuropathic pain, we use a different armamentarium. We use what we call adjuvant analgesic. What does it mean, an adjuvant? An adjuvant is a medication that was developed for other purposes, for example, an antidepressant or an anticonvulsant, but it helps us with pain as well. So this is what we try to use first, and then opioids is also in the list. 50% of the patients with neuropathic pain will benefit from opioid therapy. Easy to say, very simple, but let me show you what's really going on. And this, I think that is going to help illustrate the point that I'm trying to make. What I'm showing you here is a transversal cut of the spinal cord, and this is posterior and this is anterior. I didn't go to art in my major in college, definitely not. But this is good for what we want to do. So normally, what is that happens? You are going to have, this is a representation of the synapses there, right? So we have the periphery here, Let's say this is where the surgery was done, this is where the skin was cut. And this nerve will go to the posterior horn of the spinal cord here, where it will synapse with this other neuron, and this will go to the brain, to the cortex, where it's going to make us feel pain. So this is the synapse that is very important. It's right here in this area, lamina 1, lamina 2. So what we have is an action potential, because when you have pain, this is the signal eventually that you are generating. You are generating an electrical signal. And this electrical signal will release a neurotransmitter that will activate the neuron that goes to the brain. That's how we experience a pain. It's something that is there, that works, that is great. So we have the action potential triggered by the stimuli in the periphery. We release the glutamate, which is the neurotransmitter, and that gives the pain signal, so we retrieve the hand from the nauseous stimuli. But what happens when we have neuropathic pain? Now we don't have the stimuli in the periphery, and we have more action potentials than normally you would have. So what's the consequence of that? If you have more action potentials, you will have other neurotransmitters that normally you don't have there in the synapses. So and you have even more. You have somatostatin, you have CGRP, then you have VIP. All these normally plays a very minor role. And once you have all these guys there, you have more glutamate. You have more substance P. So you have more pain signal. And this is not good. Remember, we're not having stimuli here. This is just happening independently of whether or not you are going to have a surgery, you are going to have an incision, you are being pinched, you are being burned. This happens when you have chronic neuropathic pain. Not a good thing to have. So what is really that is happening? So what is the intimacy of what's happening? So what I did here is to a representation again of the same synapses that we were seeing before. So this is a nerve, and this is the other nerve that goes to the cortex, right? So this comes, the periphery is here. So what we have normally are proteins on the membranes that what they do is to help to propagate the action potential that we were talking about before. Remember the action potential? So we have the glutamate is going to come here, and then these molecules here will be responsible for transmitting the action potential and the pain information to the brain. Now, when you have chronic pain, besides these normal structures, then you get abnormal structures. So these normal proteins, they change. You see here, they are different, they are more. So this is very excitable. So anything will trigger pain now because you have all these changes. And this is only talking about the sodium channels in the injured nerve. But what fascinates me is that if you look at the nerves that are right next to it, that they are the survivor nerves because they have not been cut. They have total integrity, unlike this one that we have a cut right here. This one has integrity. Despite that, it experiences similar changes. And why is that? Because the injured nerves are talking to the survivor nerves. So we have here a cycle that is perpetuating. And this adds to the problem that we were talking about before. We can also look at very specifics, but this is getting a little more technical. But the bottom line is that we have the changes in the proteins that we have there. The good news is that most of the patients that are going to have surgery for Chiari, particularly when pain is the main complaint, are going to do better. The patients that I do, however, are the ones that don't do better. The ones that come to see me is those that have surgery already, the surgery didn't work, they are still having pain. And so we have to figure out what is that we can do to get them better. So the example here is just to illustrate how complex can be this area. It's just not easy to figure out where the pain is coming from, because it could be coming from these little bones here that are the facets that might be referring pain somewhere in the neck area or in the back of the head. Maybe there is not enough room here and there is pressure on the little nerves that are coming out that go to the posterior part of the head that are the occipital nerves. Maybe they are squeezed, maybe they are irritated by the mechanisms that we spoke about before. Maybe the patient has just headaches. Maybe actually you are pressing here on the roots that are coming in the arm, C5, C6, C7, C8. So all of that will be contributing to the complexity of the diagnosis. And here we are illustrating where we can find the different type of pain and how is that help us to find where the pain is coming from. This is just one example of the distribution of the nerves. We are not doing the roots here, or the dermatomes, but just to help you, to help us illustrate, like for example, if you have pain here, well, yeah, still can be coming from this area, from the base of the head, right here, right? And you can have it going into the shoulder. Well, obviously it's going to be different nerves that are being affected, but definitely you are. We have to try to figure out what is the distribution there. There is another concept which means referred pain. Is pain that you feel in a different area from where the pain is really originated from. And this is a typical example here. For example, if you, it takes the scapula right here, you have pain that is very diffuse. Sometimes it's more intense here in between the two scapula getting to the bottom of them, right here in this area. And actually it's coming from the facets, from the little bones that are keeping together the vertebral bodies together. That are keeping them together. So this is just very, very interesting, because if you don't think about this, then how are you going to do the diagnosis? And this is how we spend time talking to the patient, trying to see where the pain is coming from, and try to make a plan for that. So the patients present typically either with headaches, complaint of headaches, the TMJ, because some of the nerves are going to go to the temporomaxillary joint. Patient may have just neck pain, typical neck pain, and then you explore it further and you realize that something is going on. Patient can have pain that is just shooting down into the arm, which could be a cervical radiculopathy, can have the facet pain that we talked about before, can have shoulder pain that also we mentioned before. And they may have complications of the pain that they have as a base when it becomes chronic and neuropathic. An example of that is CRPS, C-R-P-S, that we call RSD. It's been 1992, we changed the nomenclature, but people still call it RSD, which is reflex sympathetic dystrophy, which is more difficult to treat. So well, this is what we try to figure out. Where is the patient? What is the syndrome? Because the mechanisms are different, right? And the anatomy is different. So we might have different interventions for the different type of pain. So what we have is different type of interventions. We have non-invasive interventions and we have invasive interventions. So I usually try to adequate the intervention to the presentation and I tailor it to the need of that particular patient. Now, for the purpose of this presentation, I'm going to do the non-invasive first and then the invasive. But sometimes, if it's appropriate to do a nerve block, well, we just do the nerve block. We're not gonna jump into medications if that's not necessary. So what we have is pharmacological interventions, basically means medication. So as we said before, the first line that we have is the non-steroidals, the anti-inflammatory drugs, which what they do basically is decrease the inflammation in the area where you have the injury, and by that mechanism you decrease the pain. Problem is that, obviously, it doesn't work all the time, right? And the patients may have side effects to this, so you may really have to move forward to something else. Let's say the patient comes with a pain crisis. The patient can barely move the neck, screaming, nothing is working. Well, maybe that patient will benefit with a course of steroids just for a few days, maybe a week, and then that will give you time to put other strategies in place. We use that as well. And then we have the adjuvant analgesics that we mentioned before. And the adjuvant analgesics, typically what you have is the antidepressants, like for example, the tricyclics. You have now new medications like Cymbalta, for example, that are very helpful. And you have to take advantage of the analgesic effects of them, and some patients make significant progress. We have the anticonvulsants also, where the typicals are Lyrica and gabapentin. We can make a difference here in the type of neuropathic pain that you have. If the patient has a type of pain that is neuralgic, that is like stabbing, like this, right? So maybe you want a different type of medication first. Maybe you want Tegretol first. Maybe you want Trileptal. If the pain is constant, burning, gnawing, is very intense, but it doesn't really fluctuate that much, maybe what you want to do is start with this type of medication. So you have to make the distinction there. There are other medications that we use. Muscle relaxants can be useful, not for the patients that have weakness in the neck particularly, but yes, in general, they are part of the armamentarium that we use. There is another strategy that we use a lot, which is infusions, and the infusions, we use them to break the pain cycle. You have a patient that is coming with a pain 10 out of 10, nothing worked, the patient is in distress, you can send that patient home. So that patient, you might admit them to the hospital and offer an infusion of ketamine, for example, which is the one of the strategies that we use. The reason why we use ketamine is because 50% of the patient can have significant benefit from it. You have to know how to do it because of the potential side effects associated to its use. But the beauty is that when it works, you can convert it into PO medication, so you can send the patient home on ketamine. Another strategy would be, for example, lidocaine. Lidocaine is another type of infusions that we use. And sometimes we use ketamine, sometimes lidocaine, and it depends on the patient, depends on the long-term goal of care as well. We have other non-invasive strategies, as we were saying before, within the pharmacology, for example, opioids. Opioids, it depends on who you talk to, they are great drugs or they are evil drugs. So we are now in this transitioning. The history of opioids is just very complicated. I'm not talking about 5,000 years ago in the Mesopotamia, I'm talking about now, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, when there was so much controversy if opioids should be used for cancer patients or not. What happened then is that there was a lot of lobby, a lot of understanding, many studies showed that they were helpful, and people start using more opioids. And opioids can help with neuropathic pain, and neuropathic pain in 50% of the cases, right? And the way that we use them is you start with a low potency opioid if the patient is not in a pain crisis, and then you work it up depending on the needs and the response. There are a couple of concepts that are important here, I think. One is that we use typically a combination of long-acting with short-acting medication, so the patient is not taking that many pills, and you can have a level of pain relief that is more or less stable across the board. Now, there are other things that we have to be very aware when we write an opioid, and is the side effects. In the old days, we didn't pay attention to the side effects that much. We wanted to make sure that the patient had access. We were fighting against the hurdles that were out there to preventing the patients from getting the medications. Now things have changed. We put on top of the list side effects. Why? Because the side effects sometimes can be as bothersome as the benefit that they give. So the patients may opt not to be in the opioids at all. Maybe the patient is not aware of the long-term consequences of being an opioid. So we try to educate the patients. We try to explain them that if they are going to be an opioid, well, maybe it is because it really needed, because the function with the opioid is better than the function without the opioid. If the function is decreased, then you have really to make sure that you are using the right strategy there. Because if the patient, the pain is better, but is 24/7 in bed, it's not connecting with anybody, sleeping all day, that probably is not good. So it depends on the patient. You have to figure out which is the best way to do it. Another concept that is important is tolerance. 90%, 80% of the patients, once you put them on an opioid, are going to develop tolerance. And that means that in order to achieve the same level of pain relief, you will have to increase the dose of the opioid in time. That means that if you have a patient that is on opioids for 20 years because it was properly indicated and was helping and the function was better, maybe when they started were on 10 milligrams of OxyContin twice a day, and now they are on OxyContin 400 milligrams a day, because in time you had to slowly be catching up with the tolerance. So this is something that many people now disagree on doing. The question is, what do you do with that patient? So it's easy to disagree. It's easy to say, I'm not going to do this, I'm not going to do that. But the bottom line is, what do you have to offer to the patient at that point? So that's a question that physicians have to ask themselves. The other issue is the physical dependency, meaning that your body gets used to the medication. So let's say you are developing tolerance, the dose is going up, and then you may say yourself, well, you know, I really don't want to be on these medications at these doses any longer, so I'm going to stop them. If you stop them, you're going to feel ill, and the reason is because your body got used to them. So you became physically dependent. So what we do, we slowly decrease the medications, we give other medications to help with the symptoms associated with the withdrawal, and it's a work that you do together with the patient. You have to see the patient frequently, see how they are doing, see if anything else that you can do to help them. So in my case, in general, if I use opioids post-op, is one story, is a different reasoning. So you know you're going to be on the opioids for maybe a week, 2 weeks. But if you're going to embark to treat a patient with opioids chronically, that means that it's going to be long-term, then you gotta make sure that you are not gonna discontinue the opioids in 2 months. It has to be an understanding, the patient with the physician work together, clarify what are the goals of care and make sure that you are doing the best you can for that patient. And the other issue is that patients will be at risk of addiction. You know, it's fascinating because the first study that was released, we're talking about now 30 years ago, it was a study, retrospective study in Harvard, that showed that there were less drug addiction in patients that were taking opioids and had cancer than as compared to the general population. Intuitively, it just doesn't make sense, but the data were there, so people kept citing this literature. And the concept was that patients don't get addicted. But obviously, in time, data were collected in a more proper manner, prospectively, and obviously, people will be predisposed or exposed to addiction by taking chronic opioids. So it's something that you have to have in mind when you're making this type of decisions. And then what people are talking about now is the exit strategy. So people are more worried about using opioids. Physicians are more worried about prescribing opioids. And the reason is because of the diversion, because of the increasing deaths that have been reported in the last few years. If you look at the data, for example, from 1999 or 2000 to 2009, the deaths went up from 2,000 to 6,000. It's a real problem. The question is how you deal with this. And so that's what we are trying to figure out. Some people are saying, okay, you miss one appointment, so I won't prescribe opioids for you again. Some people are saying, well, you know, you are developing tolerance, so I have to transition you to something else. But if the patient is on opioids, it's because other things haven't worked, right? If you are on opioids chronically. So this is something that it has to be looked at more carefully. Some people are very cavalier on making these decisions on what to do with patients. And then we have non-pharmacological interventions. And the ones that are more commonly used are the stimulators, right? You can use a TENS unit. Many people are familiar with that. You put it in the area of the body where it hurts, usually done by the physical therapist. They teach you how to use it. You take it home, you turn it on, you turn it off. Sometimes works, sometimes doesn't work. But definitely it's something that you can add to the medications or to the strategy you are using for that patient. There is a new strategy that we are looking into more carefully now that is called scrambler therapy. And what it does, it uses a different type of stimulation. It stimulates the nerve in the periphery. Let's say you have a cervical radiculopathy as a result of the surgery that you have. You put one electrode up here, the other one down here in the hand, and then you start dialing and stimulating. We did six patients in the last week. Of the six patients that we treated, four are pain-free today. So we are very excited. So this is one of the strategies that we are incorporating into the practice. Hopefully it will help more patients. And then the other thing that you can do is brain stimulation. And this is a very interesting concept. It has been around now for maybe 15 years. It became more popular. TDCS is one expression of it. That means transcranial direct current stimulation. The other one is transcranial magnetic stimulation. And what you do actually is to manipulate the excitability of the cortex, because in the cortex is where the pain is going to be processed. That's where all the information is going to end up. So that's what you do. You try to manipulate that. So you trick the cortex so it doesn't feel the pain. The peripheral stimulators tricks the nerves here. The stimulators, the brain stimulator, are going to trick the cortex. That's what you're trying to do. There are other things that you can do that are, for example, trigger point injections. You may tell me, yeah, but it doesn't help that much. Exactly. But what you do is to try to use different strategies. You put them together, and in that way, you can take some pains away with simple strategies. Maybe medications are on top, maybe other type of stimulations. You can do nerve blocks, obviously, particularly for the facet pain that we were talking about before, when you disrupt the architecture of the spinal column, so the joints on the side can generate pain because you've been manipulating that. So you can do a nerve block there. If it works, you can do radiofrequency ablation. That can give pain relief for 6 months. So things that are definitely worth exploring. Some patients might benefit from epidural injection, some patients from spinal cord stimulator. Now, we're talking about invasive strategies, right? So in my view, if you are going to consider a spinal cord stimulator, well, you probably have already tried some non-invasive techniques, you have tried some medications, and see how the patient is doing before jumping into that. Another strategy is the intrathecal pump. Maybe the patient is taking medications and you see that the patient is doing better, not, you know, 50% better, but still very uncomfortable, developing tolerance to the opioids. So you want to put other things into the system, but you don't have them available by mouth or by injection. So you can explore the intrathecal pump that gives you a flexibility that you don't have otherwise. Some patients benefit from that. The beauty of these two, actually, is that you can do a trial before. It's not that you have to jump into it and get implanted a pump or a stimulator. You go in the case of the stimulator, they put in the epidural space, the leads, and then you go home and you see how it works. You know, do you get better, you don't get better, helps the pain, doesn't help the pain. And based on that, the implantation of the device is decided. If it didn't work, you take the leads out. If it works, then you go again, they put new leads, fresh leads, and they put the stimulator here in the buttocks, up on top of the buttocks, and then you play with it. You can use it, you can turn it off, you can turn it on, depends on the needs that you have. With the intrathecal pump, it's a similar concept. You come to the hospital, a catheter is placed into the intrathecal space, and then an external pump is hooked to it. And then the medications are run, and you tell the doctor in the morning, I'm feeling better, I'm feeling worse. The doctor will change the combination of the medications, and if that works, then it gets implanted. So it's not that you are committing yourself to a major surgery at that point. And then what we may have are peripheral nerve stimulations that we talked about before, and that gives you a sense on where we are. So I think that there is another concept that I want to just to, so you can start thinking why is that is so difficult. It really is fascinating. So we're talking about now the changes in the brain that occurs as a result of chronic pain. So the model is not Chiari. People did the research in phantom limb pain. But still, look at the changes that you can have in the brain. Look at this. In the left side, you are having a patient with phantom pain, okay? This is phantom pain. And here we have a control. So if you ask a patient here to do this, right, to blow, they are blowing here. So you're going to have an activity, so it gets activated, the two parts of the brain that are dealing with the cheeks, right? So this is the activation that you're having in the normal person. If you look at the phantom limb pain, so you have activation here that it moves beyond the area that you would anticipate. So there is more excitability. Look what happens when you tell the patient to imagine making a fist. This patient is imagining making a fist, right? It's a control, it's a normal person, no pain. So what you get is a little bit of lightening on the area here. But look what happens when you have phantom pain. It spreads. So those are the changes that you have in the brain. This is what happens in the brain. The brain is plastic. Chronic pain causes changes in the brain. That's why we try to be aggressive treating pain, because we don't want your brain to think that this is normal, because it's not. So what do? We treat it. And if you treat it aggressively, Flora and co-workers show that then this will revert. This will go back to here when you treat chronic pain aggressively. So that's why it's a concept that I think that is very important. I'm showing you here something that I find fascinating. And you have here, this is a volunteer, and what we are doing is doing a magnetic stimulation. Here is a friend of mine at the NIH that did this study. I think that is a Republican, so you don't have to worry that much about it. But what you do, you ask the subject here to move your hand, right? To move the thumb, to do the thumb like this. You do this. And then you stimulate the brain with the magnet. So this is what the magnet does. It stimulates, so you are not doing it on purpose. You are stimulating the cortex and your thumb goes up, chick, 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 chick. You don't want to do that. You just do it because your brain is doing it for you. But what happens if you tell the patient to move the thumb down, 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 down? When you stimulate the same area, the thumb, instead of going up, it goes down. That's fascinating to me. So training can change the plasticity of the brain. So it's doing a movement that is different from the one that it was designed for. Now, if you wait a little bit, it goes back to normal. So that means that we can manipulate the brain with different strategies. The one that I'm interested in is magnetic stimulation, which is what I'm showing you here, and transcranial direct stimulation, which is the electrical counterpart that I showed you before, and it works. Look here. We're talking about changes in pain on patients that have been treated, not been treated, different parts of the brain. You can see this again. It depends on the location of the pain that you are going to have different responses, but the pains get better. The other one is the transcranial direct current stimulation that I was talking about before, which is two pads, right? It's non-invasive, again, like the TMS, non-invasive. You put one pad here in the forehead, the other one in the sensory area of the brain, and you just run 2 milliamperes of current. So this is battery operated. The amount of electricity is minimal. However, it changes the excitability of the neurons in that area. So it's just fascinating how you can manipulate it. So you have here a volunteer, she's smiling, and she has one electrode here, the other one here. This is just secure, so it doesn't fall off. Now it comes with like a helmet or something that is more fancy than this, but this is how we did in the old days. And if you look at the complaints about discomfort, so there is no difference between placebo control and the actual treatment. So it's very well tolerated, and some patients can benefit with this strategy. There are other non-invasive interventions that we can talk about that include acupuncture, physical therapy, includes also psychological interventions that I like very much. The one particularly, these are the classicals, right? Relaxation technique, hypnosis. But the one that I find more interesting lately, and I'm focusing my attention on it also, is CBT, which is cognitive behavioral therapy. And why is that? Because it's just fascinating. If you have a patient with pain, right, and you do chronic and you do cognitive behavioral therapy, and you look at the brain, you are going to see that the activity of the brain changes. It just does. And in the places that it changes are areas of the brain that are related to chronic pain. So it's a great tool. So that's why I'm recommending my patients to explore this type of strategies in addition to other things that we may do. Biofeedback would be something that we do as well. One thing that I think that not everybody thinks about it, and I think that you have to keep in mind, are the comorbidities. So when you decide on a strategy for a particular patient, you have to be aware of the person. It's not just the patient, it's an individual that has many problems, that may be depressed because cannot work, because it doesn't have an income, because it cannot take care of the kids, because 50% of the patient with chronic pain, by definition, will have depression. So that's something that we have to explore. We have to try to take care of that piece as well. And 50% of these patients will have anxiety as well. So we can't ignore it. Some doctors tell me, well, you know, I don't have the time because, you know, if 15 minutes I have to see the patient, then I have to move on to the next patient. But, you know, there was a study, was very interesting 15 years ago, done by Chachinov in Canada. And he did it with the palliative care patients, so it's a different population, I agree, but still very relevant, very interesting. What he did is compare the tools that you use to evaluate depression, that tool, the scores, with a single question to the patient, are you depressed? And the numbers were the same. So don't tell me that you don't have 5 seconds to look at the patient in the eye, connect with the patient and say, listen, are you depressed? Are you okay? How is that people don't find time to say that? Why? Because they may say, no, I'm not okay, I'm depressed, I'm suicidal, and that's what you do with it, right? So it's easier just to ignore it, but we can't because it's part of the same construct. It's an individual. You can't just take care of the pain if you are not taking care of the psychiatric piece or the emotional piece because they are connected. The pain is not going to get better if the patient continues being depressed. Now, if you are aggressive with the pain and the depression were related, well, the depression will start getting a little bit better. Maybe you have to help it with psychotherapy, with CBT, with some antidepressants. But if you see the patient as an individual, then things are going to get better. Also, when you give a medication, you have to think about comorbidity. Let's say the patient has insomnia. Well, maybe an antidepressant that gets you a little bit sleepy might be helpful, right? So you give it at night instead of giving it in the morning. Maybe an antidepressant that helps you with your appetite. That might be something else if the patient is not eating. If the patient is overweight, then you have to look for a different tool to treat the patient. So the comorbidity is very important. We have to think about that. So in conclusion, Patients with chiari can develop chronic pain, as we all know. There are multiple modalities to treat pain, as we went through them. Not getting benefit from one modality is not a predictor that you're not going to get better from another modality. So don't get discouraged. There are many things that can be explored. So I hope this helped you to have a sense on what we are doing and how we are helping patients with chronic pain. Thank you for your attention.